Hello, classic rock fans. I am reporting just a day after seeing Gladys Knight in concert at the Overture Center in Madison, Wisconsin. Gladys was performing as part of a charity fundraiser event for the Boys and Girls Club of Dane County, which is a great cause. If you don't know, she got her start back in the 60s with her group Gladys Knight and the Pips, and she's had a long, successful solo career as well. I, of course, learned of Gladys first when I saw the James Bond movie License to Kill. Got a license to kill anyone who tries to tear us up. Oh, honey. She does the theme song for that movie. I absolutely love that song. And from there, I learned more about her discography, and I love that classic 60s Motown sound that she was a part of. So, this was a rare opportunity to see her in concert, and I was so happy that I got a chance to do that, because it was a wonderful evening. It wasn't a particularly long show. She played for an hour and 5 minutes, which is a bit on the shorter side, but this wasn't a typical tour stop. This was part of a big charity event that involved multiple acts that played both before her and I guess at some sort of after party after as well. Now, we didn't have tickets to the after party, so we were only able to see the openers and then Gladys. I should also mention that Gladys is 78 years old, the same age as Mick Jagger and Paul McCartney. So that's how far back she goes, and Gladys's show was definitely about quality over quantity, and the quality of music she performed was excellent. At 78, she is still a great vocalist, and she still has a very strong stage presence. She was very charming with the audience, she spoke a little bit in between songs, expressed a lot of gratitude and appreciation, genuine gratitude and appreciation for the fans that were in attendance. You know, I've seen so many shows where, you know, right as the band's going off stage, it's thank you and good night, you know, and that's really all you hear for them. But for Gladys, each time she spoke to the crowd, she expressed a lot of love and genuine appreciation for people being there.
Thank you for being here. Thank you for us coming together. It's important that we do this.
And it gives you a sense that, you know, she's truly grateful for the lifelong fans that she has, and, you know, that she doesn't take these sort of shows for granted. And, you know, as fans, neither should we, and that just made for a very positive environment and a really charming show. She played a number of songs from her 60s Gladys Knight and the Pips days, which of course is great for old school fans, but she played some songs from her later catalog too. A good chunk of the second half of her set was some of her gospel-inspired music. Gladys Knight is very open about being a Christian, and how much faith plays a role in her life and how important that is to her. But she wasn't exactly preaching. It was just, she alluded to her faith a handful of times in between songs, but it was never obnoxious or overbearing. It was always just charming and honest, and again, made for a very wholesome night. I guess my only minor little complaint, and I always have a little minor nitpick complaint, is that I wish in between the songs, once or twice, she would have maybe told a story about the song she either had just played or was about to play, because her history in pop music is fascinating. And, you know, for the music nerd in me, I would have loved to hear her say just really anything about those songs, because that's the stuff, the little extra stuff in concerts that I, you know, as a fan, like to get a hold of. Here's an example. One of the songs Gladys played was I Heard It Through the Grapevine. Now, a lot of people don't realize, but Gladys Knight and the Pips was the first band to record that song back in the mid-60s. When they released it as a single, it was their biggest hit. It was a fairly big hit on the charts. But a couple of years later, Marvin Gaye covered it, and it became an even bigger smash hit, and he sort of overshadowed their version of the song. Well, a couple of years after that, in 1970, Creedence Clearwater Revival covered it and turned it into like an 11-minute jam session on their record Cosmos Factory, and that became a famous version in its own right. So when she started singing Heard It Through the Grapevine, I was a little surprised she didn't, you know, say something along the lines of, you might have heard this song by other bands, but we did it first. You know, just a little joke or something cute like that. But no, she just kind of started playing the song. And, you know, maybe it's a humility thing. Maybe, you know, she's not one to brag, and, you know, that's fine. But I think, you know, talking about the music you're playing is just a nice little treat for real diehard music fans who go to shows like these. But in any case, this is a pretty microscopic complaint, not really a big deal. I guess the only other thing I would whine about when it comes to the set list is she didn't play License to Kill, and I love that song. Now, I understand why she didn't play that song. It's a charity event. I don't know that it would have sort of fit the mood of the night. And frankly, that is a ballad where she really belts on that song. Maybe that's a harder song to play live, so maybe she doesn't really bust that out except for special occasions. I know she sang a little bit of it when she did her verses with Patti LaBelle a couple years ago. I caught that. That was during the quarantine of the pandemic. That was one of the things we watched, and that was a real treat because I'm a big fan of Patti LaBelle as well. So yeah, I guess I was hoping I would have heard License to Kill, but for whatever reason, wasn't part of the set, and really not a big deal. I didn't dislike any of the music she played. I thought all of the songs were really enjoyable. The ones I knew sounded great. Her voice is as strong as ever. She has some great backup singers that really added to the show as well. And again, she had a stage presence. She's 78, but she was dancing a little bit, wonking up and down the stage. Definitely having some visual interaction with the fans in the front rows. You know, one of the guys gave her a white rose, and, you know, she took a minute to thank him and, you know, talked about how much she appreciated, you know, little gestures like that.
Ain't that pretty? That's a pretty thing, boy. I'm grateful for stuff like that.
Yeah, it was just one of the most wholesome, charming shows I've ever seen. She's someone who I think is wildly underrated when it comes to that classic era of music, and it was so cool to see her doing her thing all these years later, you know? So many people from her era aren't, you know? So opportunities like these are becoming increasingly rare, and we have to appreciate these artists while we have them. I don't know that I'll ever get a chance to see her again, but if I do, I will absolutely go. If she's making an appearance by you, I would highly recommend getting tickets. Again, it won't be a long show, but it will be a really enjoyable, charming, meaningful show. And the funny thing is that as I'm recording this right now, Motley Crue and Def Leppard are playing at Miller Park right here in Milwaukee as part of their stadium tour, the much delayed and overhyped stadium tour. And when I was looking at this weekend and making my decision about whether to go out to Madison for the weekend and see Gladys Knight or stay here in town in Milwaukee and you know, shell out $100 to sit in the nosebleeds for the stadium tour. This was one of the easiest choices I've ever had to make for a concert. No regrets. If Gladys Knight and a different band is playing on the same night in your town, I don't think you could go wrong with Gladys Knight. You know, I know she's not classic rock. We mostly talk about classic rock here, but I definitely think it's important to appreciate really all genres from that classic era of music. So I will just say, if you enjoyed this concert review, please subscribe to this YouTube channel. I review almost every concert I go to, and I have a lot more videos like this through the channel, so you might find some more that you enjoy. Otherwise, if you're a fan of classic rock, again, please subscribe, and please check out the podcast I do about classic rock. We've had a lot of fantastic guests on lately, and a lot of cool stuff there. Otherwise, you can find us on Facebook and Twitter. Those links are in the description below, along with my podcast link. And if you're just a fan of Gladys Knight, I don't have any other content about her just yet, but I absolutely plan to discuss her career more at length in a future episode of my podcast. Not sure when, but some point in the future. She's definitely on the list. All right. Thanks for tuning in. Go see Gladys if she comes to your town. Keep rocking.